We had seen yesterday that if V is a finite dimensional vector space, and T from V to W is an isomorphism, then W is also finite dimensional, in fact we have dimension of W equals dimension of V. This result we had seen yesterday, okay. Let us look at the converse of this result. That is, if I have two finite dimensional vector spaces whose dimensions are the same, are they isomorphic? Okay. The answer is yes. That is what I will do today, the proof of this result, and also some consequences of the rank nullity dimension theorem. There is a little unfinished business. Okay, so this is what we will first prove today. I have V and W finite dimensional vector spaces. With the same dimension, then V is isomorphic to W. Then V is isomorphic to W. Okay, that's what we'll prove now. You will see that this is the proof is natural. Let's take two bases. So proof of this theorem, let us take u1, u2, etc., un to be a basis. This is a basis of V. I know that dimension of W is also n, and so I will enumerate a basis for the space W. Be a basis of W. The numbers are the same, the number of elements in these two bases, this number is the same. That is because dimension V is dimension W. Now what we know is that there is a linear transformation that maps each UI to the corresponding WI, and this linear transformation is unique. Okay, the only thing that we need to do is to verify that this linear transformation is invertible, injective and surjective. See, we want to show V is isomorphic to W. So we must show that this T is invertible. Okay. So let us define the mapping T from V into W by T of UI equals WI. We know that there is one such linear transformation. We also know that this transformation is unique. We must show that this transformation is invertible. From the rank nullity dimension theorem, it is enough if we show it is injective. The dimensions are the same, so it must be surjective also. So let us show that it is injective. To show that it is injective, we will show that null space of T is singleton 0. We had seen that this is an equivalent condition. So let us look at an arbitrary element in the null space of T. Then Tx equal to 0. Tx equal to 0. And this x belongs to V, and V has u1, u2, etc., un as a basis. So this is T of some linear combination alpha 1 u 1 plus alpha 2 u 2 etc. alpha n u n. T is linear, alpha 1 t of u 1 etc. plus alpha n t of u n, but t of u 1 is w 1 etc. t of u n is w n. So this is alpha 1 w 1 etc. alpha n w n. So I have this linear combination alpha 1 w 1 etc. alpha n w n equal to 0. I also know that the vectors w 1 etc. w n, they form a basis for w. So in particular they are independent. So it means alpha 1 equals alpha 2 equals alpha n equals 0. But what is x? X is alpha 1 u 1 etc. alpha n u n. So x is the 0 vector. The definition of x is given here. This is x. And so tx equal to 0 implies x equal to 0. T is a linear transformation. So T is injective by rank null determination theorem. T is surjective. So T is invertible. So T is an isomorphism. Okay. So T is an isomorphism. Hence V is isomorphic to W. V is isomorphic to W. Okay. So the dimensions coincide, then they must be isomorphic vector spaces. There is an easy corollary to this result. Let V be a real vector space of dimension n. Let V be a real vector space of dimension n, then V is isomorphic to Rn. V be a real vector space of dimension n, then V is isomorphic to Rn. We can similarly show that if V is a complex vector space of dimension n, then V is isomorphic to Cn. Okay. Remember, the dimension of Rn over R is n. That is what I mean here. Real vector space Rn is the vector space over R. Look at the vector space Cn. Cn over C also has dimension n, but Cn over R, that is also a vector space that has dimension 2n, because any complex number is an ordered pair of real numbers. Okay. To represent a complex number, you need two real numbers. So if it is a complex vector space of dimension n, then it is isomorphic to Cn, all right. If you want to write it as Rn, then it is R2n that you need to write. Okay. Okay. So this is to summarize about isomorphisms, okay, between vector spaces. As I said, I want to go back to this rank nullity dimension theorem. Look at some consequences. Okay. Please recall this result that you must have learnt in when you studied functions. Suppose X is a finite set. Then we know that a function f from X to itself. You know that a function from X to itself is this function is injective. This function is injective 1 1 if and only if f is surjective. If and only if f is bijective. Okay, I hope you have seen this result. Over finite sets, over infinite sets this is not true. Over finite sets a function is injective if and only if it is surjective, if and only if it is bijective. So again, over finite sets, it's enough if you verify that it is either surjective or injective, then it will follow that it is bijective, it is invertible. A similar result holds as a consequence of the rank nullity dimensional theorem for a linear transformation over finite dimensional vector spaces. So this is really a particular case of the rank nullity dimensional theorem, which means I will not prove this result, but I want you to compare the following result with the result that I have written down just now. Okay, this theorem is a consequence of rank nullity dimension theorem, and the proof is left as an exercise. Let T from V to V be linear, and V be finite dimensional. T is linear, V is finite dimensional, T is an operator on V, T is a linear transformation from V to itself, okay, that is an operator. Then the following are equivalent, then the following statements on T are equivalent. First statement is T is injective . Second statement is T is surjective. That statement, for instance, I could include null space of T equals singleton 0. I could include one more statement, range of T is the whole of V. But these are equivalent statements, easy consequence of the rank nullity dimension theorem. For instance, look at A implies B, or A if and only if B. T is injective if and only if null space of T is singleton 0, which from the rank nullity dimension theorem tells us that rank of T is n, but rank of T is a dimension of the range space of T, it is a subspace of V. V has dimension n, this subspace has dimension n, so this subspace must be equal to the entire V, and so range of T equals V. So T is surjective, etc. Okay, so there is nothing new in this result. It is only a particular case of rank nullity dimension theorem where instead of W I have taken V. And this also allows us to compare with the result that I have stated here. For a function over finite sets, injectivity is equivalent to surjectivity, equivalent to bijectivity. But what happens in the infinite dimensional case? In the infinite dimensional case, this result is not true. Okay, that is the reason why there is this restriction. So let us look at an example. I want to give an example of a linear operator, say which is surjective but not injective. So look at the following. Consider V as the vector space, the real vector space of all polynomials whose coefficients are real numbers defined over the variable t. T is a real variable. Now this is an infinite dimensional vector space. For instance, this is a subspace of C01, the space of continuous functions, which we have shown is infinite dimensional. Of course, being a subspace of an infinite dimensional space does not mean this must also be infinite dimensional, but then we know that 1t, t square, etc., they are linearly independent. So this is for infinite dimensional. V is infinite dimensional. The same idea that we used to prove C01 is infinite dimensional applies here. Let us define the differentiation operator. Define D from V to V. Any polynomial is infinitely many times differentiable. So define D from V to V by DF of T to be what is the form of f? Depending on that, df of t will be defined. So let me say df of t, where f of t, now f is in V, so f is a polynomial. F of t is, let us say, alpha naught plus alpha 1 t, etc., plus alpha n t to the n. Then df t is defined as alpha 1 plus the next term is alpha 2 t square, that is 2 alpha 2 t plus etc. plus n alpha n t to the n minus 1. This is the definition of D, the so called differentiation operator. Takes a polynomial, computes its derivative, that is the operator D. Then since differentiation operator is a linear transformation, this D is linear, okay, you can apply it to each term, this D is linear. Let me also define, by the way, is D injective? What is the null space of D? Null space of D is set of all constants. Constant polynomials. Okay, so D is not injective. D is not injective. Okay, so let us now define another operator, this is the so called indefinite integral operator, we will do that. So I am going to define another operator, I will call that T, T from V to V is defined by, let us take okay, Tg of T, what is the form of G? If g of t is let us say beta naught plus beta 1 t etc. beta l t to the l, then I will do this so called indefinite integration, that is integral of this, which is beta naught t plus beta 1 t square by 2 etc. plus beta l t to the n plus 1 by l plus 1. So this is what I will define for the operator t, the so called indefinite integral. Okay, this is like integral 0 to t g of t dt. This is again linear, this t is linear. Okay, what about range of t? Okay, what about null space of t? T is injective, okay. T is injective. Let us look at the relationship between D and T. Look at the relationship between D and T. What about TD? What do you expect TD to be? You first differentiate and integrate. Okay, let us start with DT. What is DT? DT is identity, okay. Please check this, DT is identity. What about TD? TD, for example, for constants, if you apply, you will see that it is 0. So TD cannot be identity. TD cannot be identity. So what's the moral of the story? The moral of the story is, see, this D is not injective, but it has a right inverse. D is not injective. Okay. The operator D that we have defined is not injective. D has a right inverse. From this, it can be shown that D is surjective. I'm going to leave this as an exercise. From this, it can be shown that D is surjective. Okay. What about T? T is injective, but you can verify that T is not surjective because of this. Okay, that is also an exercise for you. T is not surjective. This T is injective. Let me say this right away implies T is not surjective. Okay, so I have given an example of an operator over an infinite dimensional space. One operator which is injective but not surjective, the other operator which is surjective but not injective. Okay, differentiation operator is surjective but not injective. The indefinite integral operator is injective but not surjective. Okay, so please check these calculations, and so this result is not true for infinite dimensional spaces. There are other consequences. In particular, let me give this little exercise using rank nullity dimension theorem. One could solve this problem. Let T from V to V be linear with V finite dimensional. Suppose that null space of T equals range of T. Suppose that null space of T equals range space of T. V is finite dimensional. What is the conclusion that you could draw on the dimension of V? It's even. Then dimension of V is even. It's an even positive integer. Okay, now that's an easy consequence of the rank nullity dimension theorem. But what I want you to do is to give an example of such a linear transformation. Give an example of one such transformation T. Okay. Now, in order to sort out this second problem, I'll give one hint. T is an operator that satisfies the condition null space of T is range of T. Okay. Then first try to show that T square equal to 0. Null space of T equals range of T. Show that this implies T square is 0. T square is a 0 operator. Construct an operator that satisfies this condition. To construct an operator that satisfies this condition, you construct a 2 by 2. For example, let's construct T over R2, T from R2 to R2. Remember, the spaces must be the same. Otherwise, null space of T and range of T. Null space of T is a subspace of V, range of T is a subspace of W. So when I talk about equality, I can do that only when the domain is equal to the codomain. Take T from R2 to R2. You want to construct T such that T square is 0. Start with the matrix A that satisfies the condition A square equal to 0. Use that matrix A and then construct the linear transformation. Tx equals Ax. So that I am going to leave with you as an exercise. But what you can try is the converse true? That is a related question. If T square equal to 0, then does it follow that range of T equal to null space of T? That's another question. So construct an example T that satisfies this. Verify if the converse is true. Okay. One final application of the rank nullity dimension theorem is to show that the row rank of a matrix is the column rank of that matrix. This statement was made long time ago when we discussed elementary row operations, row equivalence, etc. So we would like to prove the following theorem. We would like to show that the row rank of A equals the column rank of A. Okay. Before that, what is the row rank? What is the column rank? So before I prove, so let's recall these definitions. The row rank of a matrix is defined to be the dimension of the row space of A. The row rank is the dimension of the row space of A. The column rank is the dimension of the column space of A. Okay, as we have observed, the row rank, the row space rather, is a subspace of Rn. The column space is a subspace of Rm. Is that clear? Each row has n coordinates, each column has m coordinates. So the column space is a subspace of Rm, and the row space is a subspace of Rn. Okay. So it's an interesting and an important result that these spaces may lie in different, these subspaces may lie in different spaces, but their ranks are the same, their dimensions are the same. This is another consequence of the rank nullity dimension theorem, but we need a little work before settling this identity. So let's recall what we did for row reduced echelon matrices. Let me first prove this result. Let's start with two matrices of the same order, which are related by the equation A and B, related by this equation B equals P times A, where P is a square matrix of order M. So this is m cross m, m cross n. The product is m cross n, B is m cross n. What I want to do is to conclude that if B is equal to PA, then the row space of B is contained in the row space of A. I want to conclude the row space of B is contained in the row space of A. To prove this, I will invoke what we had seen earlier, that anything, okay, so I'm going towards the proof of this. Look at AX for any X. A is n, m cross n. Look at AX for any X. This is in the column space of A. This we have seen before. In particular, I wrote this AX as, okay, I want to conclude that AX is in the column space of A. Why is that so? You can see that if I write A as A1, A2, etc., An, these are the n columns of A with A1, A2, etc., An being the columns of A. If A is equal to this, then we can verify that AX is X1 A1 plus X2 A2, etc. plus xn an, where I have used x is the column vector, x1, x2, etc., xn. Okay. Now, this we have observed before. See, what you have on the right is linear combination of the columns of A. What I am saying is that this is precisely Ax, where A is a matrix that we started with and x is this column vector. Okay. That is to reinforce Ax is in the column space of A. Okay. Let's go back to this equation, B equal to P times A. Now, B equals P times A, after taking transposes, using the fact that transpose satisfies a reverse order law, this gives me B transpose as A transpose P transpose. B transpose is A transpose P transpose. Let me call this as A transpose Q. So, Q is P transpose. Q is P transpose. Let me write Q. See, P is M cross M, so Q is also M cross M. Q has M columns, M rows. So let me write Q as Q1, Q2, etc., Qm. Again, these are the columns of Q. Just as how I wrote down the columns A1, etc., An for A, these are the columns of Q. Let me write down the columns of B transpose. I will call that B1, B2, etc. B transpose is B1, B2, etc. B is of order m cross n, so there are n columns. B transpose will have m columns. So B1, B2, etc. Bm. B is m by n. So B transpose is n by m. In particular, number of columns of B transpose is m. The columns of B transpose, I am denoting them by B1, B2, etc., Bm. Okay. Please be clear about the notation here. I am using A1, etc., An for A, Q1, etc., Qm for Q, but B1, etc., Bm for B transpose. Okay, for simplicity. Okay. Now look at this equation once again. B transpose is A transpose Q. B transpose equals A transpose Q gives me B1, B2, etc., Bm equals A transpose Q1, Q2, etc., Qm, and this is something we have seen before. You can push the matrix inside. This is A transpose Q1, A transpose Q2, etc., A transpose Qm. Okay, that is A into Q1, Q2, etc., Qm, A transpose into Q1, Q2, then this matrix can be pushed inside. This can be verified by matrix multiplication. I remember having told you this before. In particular, look at B1. B1 is the first column of B transpose. B1 is in the column space of B transpose. B1 is in the column space of B transpose. Then B1 transpose is in the rows. Okay. Then B1 is in the row space of B. B1 is in the row space of B. Column space of B transpose, row space of B. See, in fact, you will observe that B1 is the first column of B transpose. So B1 is the first row of B. In particular, it is in the row space of B. Okay. Look at what you have on the other side. A transpose B, but B1 is A transpose Q1. Okay. Look at A transpose Q1 in its own right. A matrix times a vector. That is a column vector of A transpose. Is it clear that A transpose Q1 is let me say in the, let me say it is the first column of, let me rewrite. See, I want to make use of this fact that AX is in the column space of A. A transpose Q1 is in the column space of A transpose. A transpose Q1 is in the column space of A transpose. So it is in the row space of A. A transpose Q1 is in the row space of A. It is in the column space of A transpose, so it is in the row space of A. It is a linear combination of the columns of A transpose, which is a linear combination of the rows of A. So what have we proved? On the one hand, it is B1 is in the row space of B. On the other hand, it is in the row space of A. So if B is equal to PA, we have shown that the rows of B are linear combinations of the rows of A. That is the first statement. Okay, let me write. I want to prove the statement. What we first observed is that if B equals PA, then the row space of A, sorry, the row space of B is contained in the row space of A. If B is equal to PA, then the row space of B is contained in the row space of A. That is what we have proved just now. Suppose P is invertible, then I can pre-multiply by P inverse. If P is invertible, by pre-multiplying by P inverse, I get I write A as P inverse B. Okay. So what I have done is, you can call this S times B. I have written A as S times B. Apply the same idea. If A is S times B, then the row space of A is contained in the row space of B. The argument we have given just now can be applied here in this case. So this implies row space of B, sorry, row space of A is contained in row space of B. Okay, if this matrix P is invertible, then I get this result, which means if A equals, if B equals PA with P invertible, then the row spaces of A and B are the same. In particular, row equivalent matrices have the same row space. Because if A and B are row equivalent, then A can be written as P times B, where P is a product of elementary matrices. So row equivalent matrices have the same row space. If A is row equivalent to B, then the row space of A equals the row space of B. That is because A can be written as P times B for some invertible matrix P. Look at the row. Okay. Now I want to determine a basis for the row space of A. I want to determine a basis for the row space of A. Look at the row reduced echelon form R of the matrix A. R is a row reduced echelon matrix, row equivalent to A. Okay, as before, R is a row reduced echelon matrix, row equivalent to A. Then the first, let us take R to be the number of non-zero rows of R. Small r equals the number of non-zero rows of capital R. Okay, what is the dimension of the row space of A? Can you see that it is R? For the following reason, what is the row space of R, capital R? Row space of R is the subspace consisting of the linear combination of the rows of A. Now r, first r zeros, first r rows are non-zero, the rest n minus r are 0. So the n minus r zero rows don't contribute anything to the row space. It's only the contribution that comes from the first r non-zero rows of capital R. So the row space of capital R is spanned by these r vectors. Are these r vectors linearly independent? We need to verify that, but that's easy. An argument similar to the standard basis can be given. Okay, instead of just mentioning it, let me write down the form of R, and it will be clear from the first R non-zero rows that these non-zero rows are linearly independent. In fact, remember this is how we used to write. We have certain zeros, then there is a 1 and some entries here, then some zeros here, 1 appears to the right of this, some other entries, etc. Finally, I have lots of zeros here, this, and then I have the 0 rows. That is, I have this corresponds to the n minus r 0 rows. I am writing down r, this is my matrix r. These are then r non-zero rows. And it is clear that these behave somewhat like the standard basis vectors. So you take a linear combination alpha 1 times this vector plus alpha 2 times this vector, etc., alpha r times this vector, equate that to 0, then right away the first equation gives you alpha 1 0, second equation gives you alpha 2 0. They do not lie along the same column, they are in different columns. That is, if this is in C1, this is in C2, etc., this is in CR, then we know C1 less than C2 less than C3, etc., less than CR. So it is clear that these r non-zero rows, the first r non-zero rows of R, are independent and that they span the row space of R, and so the dimension of the row space of A is equal to R. Dimension of row space of A equals R, where R is the number of non-zero rows of the row reduced echelon form of A, that is row rank of A. That is equal to R. Row rank of A is equal to R. We need to show that the column rank of A is also R. Okay. For the column rank, we need to do a little more. So let me see how much I can cover. Now for the column rank, I want to start all over again. Consider A in R m cross n that I started with earlier. Look at the system Ax equal to 0, collect all the solutions, call that as S. S is the solution set of the homogeneous system of equations Ax equal to 0. Okay. Remember that you can call this as the kernel of A. Only thing is we have defined kernel of a linear transformation. What is the kernel of a matrix? Through this matrix you can define a linear transformation, and then the kernel of that linear transformation is the kernel of this matrix. Okay. But in any case, what I want to say is this S is a subspace. This is a subspace of Rn, set of all xn Rn. So this is a subspace of Rn. Okay. I would like to calculate the dimension of this subspace. It cannot exceed n, I know. I want to calculate the dimension of the subspace. I want to conclude that the dimension of the subspace is n minus r. Then it will follow that the column rank is r, which is the same as the row rank of A. Okay, so I want to conclude the dimension of the subspace is n minus r. To calculate the dimension, I also observe that if capital R is a row reduced echelon form of A, then the solution set of Rx equal to 0 and Ax equal to 0 are the same. I will use this to calculate the dimension of S. I will use the row reduced echelon form R to calculate the dimension of S. Let us go back and write down these equations and analyze this once again. Let me in this case use this notation. J is the subset of all indices 1, 2, 3, etc. n which do not have C1, C2, etc. Difference C1, C2, etc. CR. C1 is the column in which the leading non-zero entry of the first row appears. C2 is the column in which the leading non-zero entry of the second row appears, etc. Okay. I remove these indices from the indices 1, 2, 3, etc. n. Then I can write down the I can expand this. We have done this before, but I will do it using this notation. You will see it is the same. As before, xc1, xc2, etc., xcr correspond to those variables out of x1, x2, etc., xn that correspond to these columns. Okay. Then xc1 plus, we write summation j equals 1 to n minus r, but this time it is summation j over j. Let me say I have C1, no, C1 I cannot use. Let us say alpha 1 j x j equals 0. Etc. x c r plus summation j element of j alpha r j x j equal to 0. Okay, probably I will stop here and then continue next time. Okay, remember that I want to show that the dimension of this subspace is n minus r. That would show that the column space of A is r dimensional, which means the column rank of A is r, the same as the row rank of A.